Good morning and a happy Independence Day to all. Thank you for joining us on day three of Charcha 2021. We will now begin our panel discussion on credit mobilization. We are delighted to have our panel with us here today. Dr. Chintala, Mr. Arun Raste, Mr. Anil Kumar, and Mr. Rahul Gupta. Ms. Monica Halan will be helping to moderate our discussion. Dr. Chintala is the chairman of the National Bank for Agricultural and Rural Development. He's also the chairman of Asia Pacific Rural and Agricultural Credit Association, an association of 24 countries. He was recently awarded Asia's Most Promising Business Leader Award 2021 by the Economic Times. Welcome, sir. Mr. Arun Raste is Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer, NCDEX. He has over three decades of experience across the development sector. In his prior assignment, he was associated with the National Dairy Development Board as an executive director. Welcome to you. Mr. Anil Kumar is the founder and CEO of Samunati, an organization with a mission to make markets work for smallholder farmers. He has received awards from several forums, most recently the ET Social Enterprise Startup Award in 2020. Mr. Anil is a career banker with close to three decades of experience in the areas of rural, retail, and agri-banking. Welcome, sir. Mr. Rahul Gupta is Chief Executive Officer, Avanti Finance Private Limited. He is responsible for defining and delivering Avanti's mission to provide timely, affordable credit to the unserved and underserved segments, leveraging new age digital technologies. With over 27 years of deep domain expertise in consumer finance, he has held leadership positions both in India and other countries. Welcome. Ms. Monica Halan will be moderating the conversation today, as I mentioned. She is a trusted personal finance writer, speaker, and author who helps families get their money decisions right. She's a best-selling author of Let's Talk Money, an adjunct professor at the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs. She is a regular speaker on financial literacy, regulation, inclusion, and consumer issues in retail finance. Welcome, Monica. And over to you to get us started on credit mobilization.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Roshni. Delighted to be here on such a special day. It is indeed, I think, all our pleasure that we can be a part of this conversation on 15th August. The topic I know is credit mobilization, but given the breadth of the people on the panel, I will take the liberty of broadening it a bit as we go along. And just by way of a small introduction, I saw a paper 2 days back by Dun & Bradstreet, which is saying that that agriculture actually recorded the highest new business registration in FY21 of 12,368 entities compared to 6,000 entities in the last fiscal. So there's been 103% jump in new registration in agribusiness. And the agricultural share in GDP in FY21 almost hit 20% after a gap of two decades. This was, of course, more due to the fall of the other two sectors, but yet there is a story in agriculture, which possibly we are not hearing because of the noisy political discourse on the borders of Delhi. But should we plug into some of the conversations which are not political, but are oriented towards business, towards work, we hear a very, very different story of Indian agriculture. Of course, the problems remain, they will persist, but there is, we sense, a political will for reform. And the animal spirits are finally waking up in agriculture. And that's a great thing. We're going to debate some of the issues relating to the financialization of agriculture. The issue is, of course, more than credit. So instead of credit plus, I want to call it financialization. And because linked to this really are the issues which are of great importance to all of us, of productivity, of efficiency, of marketability. And I'm going to first ask the panelists to map some of the interesting, unexpected, hopeful things which might have happened in the last 5 years. The last 5 years, we had thought that
I mean, that was the discourse, that agriculture is going to implode. Demonetization was supposed to really be that big event which was going to kill agriculture. And then COVID was going to finish that job. But that's not what really has panned out, has it? It's been a very eventful half a decade. There's been a whole lot of creative destruction. I'm hoping that each of the panelists here will map some of the areas in their individual domains, which tell us what has happened in these 5 years. And then we can come to the problems in the next part of the conversation. I'm going to start with you, Anil, because you've got really a very wide angle with which you look at the space. In the last 5 years, maybe four or five big stepping stones that tell you that things have changed.
Wonderful to be here among friends to share some of the learnings, Monica. And again, couldn't have been a better day to discuss this, the 75th Independence Day of this wonderful country. And wonderful that you are also starting the discussion on the positives, you know, on the green twigs, the green shoots that we are seeing. For me, the last 5 years in agriculture have been nothing short of a miracle. I have spent about 25 years of my professional experience in rural and agri space, in the debit credit dimension of life, you know, in the banking. And when Samunati took birth as an entity, as an enterprise, we said we will focus only on agriculture and nothing else. And it was not long ago, it was 2014, that I started socializing the idea of having an entity that focuses only on agriculture lending and nothing else. And all that the market knew, including the well-informed financial markets, Monica, at that point in time, were: one, agriculture is equal to crop loans. People did not understand that agriculture is actually a sector. And within crop loans, there are only two narratives that, you know, that I heard people talk about. One, when it comes to farmer, it is the extreme step that you know, poor family takes, which is all over the place. So people understand farming only with the farmer suicides. When it comes to lending, the farm loan waivers is the only topic that, you know, people are aware of. Nothing in between. So it took actually 4 months for me to tell the early stage investors that agriculture is not crop loan. There is a lot that happens before the seed goes into the soil and a lot that happens after the seed is harvested. No doubt there are risks between this phase of, you know, seed going into the soil and the harvest happening. There are risks, no doubt about it. But a lot happens on either side of this value chain. 4 months. And fortunately for me, I found my first investor biting the grain. I would not say biting the bullet. From then to now, while people are talking about tailwinds in agriculture, I would say the sector is actually experiencing a buoyancy. You see the uplift in several facets of what this sector represents. First and foremost, the validation of this buoyancy is the flow of private capital. The number of entities that are mushrooming, and I'm using this word very deliberately, it's nothing short of mushrooming. The number of startups that are coming in, and you see every other day, Your Story or Better India has some wonderful work that is, you know, that is happening in one nook and corner of this city, which is of this country, which is promising. The number of startups, I understand, are more than 700 in the you know, last few years. And the entrepreneurial energy that we are seeing, youngsters coming in, bringing all kinds of technology tools that can, you know, that can solve the niche problems in agriculture, whether it is in quality testing to what to sow and soil testing. Quality testing after harvesting, soil testing before you sow anything. That's the dimension that we are seeing. The second dimension is the entire narrative around the principle of aggregation has changed significantly. Earlier, the aggregation, prior to the wonderful SHG movement that NABARD has brought to this country, you know, was cooperatives. Now again, the prejudice that cooperative brings in is the governance structure. But people forgot that behind this governance structure, there is a principle of cooperation, the collective benefit, which was the root cause how cooperatives came in. Then the SHG movement, and now the farmer producer company leading to farmer producer organization. That C becoming O is significant. What was C is one legal form of a farmer producer collective, which is farmer producer company registered as registered under Indian Companies Act. But the O now encompasses the cooperatives, encompasses the other legal forms which bring in the spirit of cooperation. That expands the universe to 200, 300,000 entities that are there in this country. That's a significant dimension of how the the aggregation principle is evolving and expanding the scope. And of course, I mentioned about the private capital flowing in, the amount of the early deals, the seed money, all the way to now we are talking of Series D, Series E's in agriculture. And who knows, before 77th Independence Day, we may actually have a publicly listed agri entity. Who knows? That's the kind of energy that we are seeing in the market in terms of why agriculture is becoming.
What I'm hearing is that's right, Anil. I'm hearing what you've found in the last 5 years is private capital, animal spirits, as I said, startups are there, and this big move of changing the legal structure of a cooperative from company to organization. That's the big one. I want to then come to you, Arun. So credit has actually been the pampered child, exactly what Anil said. All the entire attention was on credit, and there has been a Mother India kind of way of looking at credit in India. But there's been a whole financialization story. Do tell us some of those interesting threads in the story coming from the view of a market entity, an exchange, something that very few people understand in India of what an exchange does, and the crucial role of financialization of a sector, which really rests on what the exchange does. And of course, the story is far more difficult in agriculture as compared to paper assets. For instance, what role would Comtrack might have played, the electronic accounting system? Some of the other stepping stones over the years, Arun. Arun, your mic is off.
Good morning, Monica. A couple of things I'll take from where Anil has left, and then address what exactly you were saying. So one interesting thing which has happened in my previous two avatars, which I have seen, is the milk producer companies, and they precede the farmer producer companies. So I'll give you just one small example. There is a company called Shija Milk Producer Company, which collects milk from three states, Andhra, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu. This is world's largest only women-owned company. They collect milk from about 80,000 women and transport their milk all the way to Delhi. So in Delhi, if you get Mother Dairy milk, one of the suppliers is Shija, which is based out of Tirupati in Tamil Nadu. So the farmer producer bill which came in, the dairy sector, the milk producer companies were predecessors to that. And that is something which, Anil was mentioning about cooperation. So that cooperation in the form of a company has again been an experiment which the milk sector has started. Amul and the whole Nandini, Virka, whichever state you go, you will find a cooperative milk producer company, organization. These are all cooperatives which have grown manifold. Amul is a 35,000 crore organization now, but it's a cooperative. But these are producer companies I'm talking about, like Shrija or Pais in Rajasthan, Mahi in Gujarat. There are many milk producer companies who have more than, say, 70,000. Pais has 100,000 members. These are companies, and there's a very successful model. And somebody like, say, Mahi in Gujarat, which is based out of Rajkot, has 32 crore share capital. This is a company under registrar of companies, so it is not a cooperative. And that is a very successful example. Now, coming to your second question, what my present entity, Exchange, can do and what is happening, which is very good. So I was speaking to the other day to one of the FPO members in Madhya Pradesh. And these are the belts where soybean is grown. And one of the FPO members and the FPO executives, they said every morning we check the NCDX sticker. Now, Madhya Pradesh, which is a highly Hindi-speaking state, where possibly the words like NCDX and ticker would have been something unheard of about 5 years ago. They talking about NCDX ticker. So I asked them, why do you see the ticker? He says, we do two things. We see when monsoon is entering Kerala, and then we start seeing the NCDX ticker. So we see what is the future rate of soybean 3 months down the line, the future contracts. And then based on that, we make a decision as to what we need to sow. So the farmer today is strategically thinking in terms of what he or she needs to sow in their farms based on the futures price. Now, what has happened is an entity like NCDX is assuring them that 3 months down the line, your current price of soybean might be 6,000, but 3 months down the line, it would be 6,500 or 7,000, whatever, XYZ. Based on that, they are deciding whether they need to sow soybean or they can go for some other crop. And that is a very, you know, basic change in farm practices, which we can understand. Because what happens is, if the farmer doesn't know what is likely to get him remunerative income at the time of harvesting, everybody will sow the same thing, and then the, you know, possibly the whole market will put the prices down and he will be squeezed. And that is something which the exchange has enabled farmers to ensure that his income doesn't go down. So that is one. The second is, you know, the price discovery mechanism is something which the farmers and rather FPOs now understand, and which they are trying to promote within the farmers now. So how do you discover the prices of your own company? There's something called options, and options is working like insurance. Last year, luckily for us, our regulator SEBI was very supportive of options. So what we did was, we enabled some of the FPOs to buy options on behalf of farmers. So they could lock in prices. Say soybean, if the price is locked at 6,500 at the time of harvest, they could lock in. So any downward movement, they will still get 6,500 rupees. If there is upward movement, obviously they can sell it in the market. So that lock-in was something which is provided by exchange in the form of options. And this is something very, very new. People are talking about crop, you know, insurance. But that insurance has not unfortunately worked in India. But this is a mechanism which is working. Again, it is working better than MSP. Your price is assured. So these could be some things which are market driven, but they will also help reducing the burden of government of India in terms of MSP, in terms of crop insurance. And that is a very, very positive thing which the exchange mechanism, the market mechanism has done today in the last 5 years.
Right, Arun. And it is, for a person who understands markets and has always been on the defensive when people attack stock markets and financialization as this sort of, it immediately goes into some weird socialist mindset. So it's a great delight when I'm hearing that futures data is being used by farmers. It's music, because we're actually progressing. And this whole price discovery and use of option as insurance, because you preempted my question. I was going to ask that, yes, I as a farmer, I can use the future data, but what if? And you answered that question immediately with saying that option is being used as insurance. And we have an insurance sector which is still
grappling.
Unfortunately, in the 1970s mindset, we haven't seen a modern insurance sector. There are regulatory issues there. But again, to see options being used is just fantastic. And I'm going to move to Rahul. And if we are saying that credit is a part of financialization, it is not the full story. What is it that we can say that has been the big change in the way credit is being raised, disbursed, and recovered? And would you agree that once the other pieces are in place, the credit story actually becomes easier?
Firstly, good morning, everyone, and a great day to be together on this panel on the 75th Independence Day. Monica, to your question, I think I'll just step back a bit and try and also contextualize it with what Arun and Anil also mentioned in the panel earlier. So, specific to credit, I mean, if you look at it, we're a country of 1.3 billion people, with about half the population engaged in agriculture. So when we talk about financial inclusion, how can we be successful unless this core is served, and which we know is highly underserved at this point of time? So coming to your earlier point, which is what's happened well in the last 5 years, I think the world has clearly moved in terms of not making this problem just something that the government needs to solve, but where you are now seeing increased participation and jugalbandi between, you know, Samaj, Sarkar, and Bazaar, without which we will not make progress. So, you know, from all the good work that the government has done, especially in terms of policy making, credit facilitation, the various schemes that we have for the bottom of the pyramid, Secondly, the digital infrastructure that has been created in India, which allows you to build delivery mechanisms to reach more and more people at the bottom of the pyramid and in a more cost-friendly way. And next step also being that if you want to take this further, how do you overcome the barriers of customers being data dark? And this combination of factors is something that will propel the country forward. So, you know, the government, the social foundations, commercial capital, impact capital, all of this needs to come together to really sort of give it the desired push going forward.
Right.
The technology layer is going to be extremely important here, because when you want to create solutions at a population scale, it's not going to happen if it's going to be high touch models. So speaking, and that's kind of a little bit about the genesis of why Avanti was set up, which is saying, whilst we see a lot of progress that has happened towards addressing credit to the underserved, and a large part of it is, of course, related to the agri and agri-allied sector, we still aren't even close to solving the issue, because we have about 100 million households who are still out of the formal credit system. And that's a very big number. Mm-hmm. Now, while recognizing the progress, now one has to see that basis some of the infrastructure that has been built, how do we at least change the game in the next 5 to 10 years?
Yeah. So, Rao, I'll come to that. I'll come to the problems piece. And what I've heard you say is that I love the phrase Samad Sarkar Bazaar. There's been a coming together, and that's a very, very powerful combination if it does actually come together. So this whole colonial mindset of the Samaj being against the Sarkar, and therefore you deface government properties. You know, there's been a whole colonial way that we have behaved because of the baggage that we've carried off a foreign ruler. But if Samaj and Sarkar actually starts to work together, because it is your actually asset, it's paid out of your taxpayer money, then you are thinking of a very different country. And of course, the digital infrastructure. So I'm actually going to come back to the problem piece and go to Dr. Chintala. I hope he's there. Dr. Chintala, are you? Can you hear us? Dr. Chintala, are you there? Okay. I'm going to now come to the problems piece, and maybe Rahul, you can just carry on. And the way that I want to discuss the problem areas in every sector is not to reimagine the world, because nobody ever gets a clean slate. It has to be incremental. And now, given the fact that there is something which is very new in India, which is political will, what according to you will be a few of the areas which need to be solved? Like you said, millions of households still are credit negative. You know, so what areas do you want to map, which are the problems in going ahead, making agriculture into not a drag, but really the leader in the agriculture manufacturing services equation?
So I think, again, if we look at, and to your topic, Monica, today, you used a term which was financialization, which goes beyond just credit.
Right.
So I think when we look at it, the first and foremost thing is that how do you build fit and proper products, be it credit, be it insurance, be it, you know, linkages that Arun spoke about. How do you sort of enable all of that? Now, coming again from a perspective of, we actually feel that access to financial services is extremely important. Now, how do you first solve for access in a manner that goes across the board, is fairly democratized, and something that looks at the scale at which the problem that India needs to address? Now, if we look at, for example, one is the supply. So if you look at credit, for example, as just one product, and we know it goes beyond that, it's the supply of credit. Now, given the large swell of population that still needs to come into the formal credit system, and large part of that is agriculture, we find this a big challenge. Now, you might have in the agronomy space, in the ag tech space, in the fintech space, we might still, we are seeing a lot of momentum, but it's nowhere close to what is required. And this is where we feel that, you know, if I was to sort of put a wish list together, how can the government, how can, with the RBI support, et cetera, can there be like a wholesale funding entity which really looks at saying, okay, there's a big quantum of credit supply that needs to be addressed and at rates which the people we're trying to serve are able to service? How do we address that? Because so far, it's kind of, there hasn't been so much of structural solutions that have come here. Okay. And especially not to jump into the sort of next level of problem solving that we need to do. So I would say that's one.
Okay.
And the second thing that I would say is that, and this is where, again, social capital, private capital, government capital has to, that corpus needs to come together to solve for this problem very, very specifically. So that would be one input that I have.
Okay, great. So problems, as I've understood, linkages which need to be in place and the supply of credit, which you're saying the pipeline has to be larger and more directed.
Both the quantum and the quality.
And the quality of the supply. So correct. I'm actually going to come to you, Anil, to one, just unpack this a bit and then go on to your own issues that you think the whole financialization story has. But if I'm going to stay with the problem of, say, linkages and supply, which Rahul has just mapped, do you see that right now as a roadblock, or do you think there is actually a lot of action happening in the linkages and supply of credit? It's just not through the traditional methods that we have understood. So your inputs on that, yeah.
No, I really like the construct that Rahul has given, Samaj, Sarkar, and Bazaar. So yes. Rahul, with your permission, I'll use a little bit of this. So the
please
way
do, Anil, in fact, the more people evangelize this, the better it is. It is something that I have also learned in the concept of societal platforms. This is by no means my term.
Super. So I got to know thanks to you and Monica. So I'll use this. So Monica, the way I understand the whole landscape of both the supply of credit and services plus the action that is happening in the markets, in the bazaar. The framework that comes to me is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. We all are familiar with the, with the psychological safety, all the way going to self-actualization. If I apply that to the agriculture landscape, I see the following five steps. Step number one is access to finance that Rahul mentioned. Access to finance, access to customized finance is the second order need. The third order is access to customized finance with market linkages. Can you also help me to market what I have produced? The fourth one is access to customized finance with market linkages together with advisory services. Hey, can you tell me how to produce what you are looking for, or what do I produce that you are looking for? And the last one, the self-actualization piece, is access to customized financial services with the market linkages and advisory services, together with the risk mitigations like the, like the options, like guarantee structures, as well as customized insurance products. Now, these are two ends of the spectrum. And the way I am seeing it, not, hypothesizing here, is if you approach this framework from the dimension of the Samaj part of it, we tend to go to the, psychological and safety needs. Hey, can I provide access to finance? Because there are a lot of people who don't even have access to financial services. And, I start from there. But if you approach this framework from the bazaar perspective, I would say we have to start with the, the self-actualization dimension of it, where an integrator, a full stack company, looks at this entire landscape from, hey, how can I bring in customized financial services? How can I bring in the market forces into buying what the farmers are producing at the farm gate? how can I lace the, you know, advisory services, how to produce, how much to produce, the price sticker that, you know, Arun mentioned about, how do I bring in all of this? Lace that with the risk mitigations that are available in terms of options, in terms of customized insurance products for the lenders, as well as, you know, the other risk mitigations that we have, including the data integrity that we were just chatting about. To make this bazaar approach to happen, you need entities who are integrators, you know, the likes of Zubin Mehta's, you know, who bring in all the plays together to make a symphony. And that, I feel, is the bazaar-led approach. And I feel these two are two dimensions, but the bazaar-led approach will be much more impactful in the short run because all the ingredients are there. Mal masala sab hai market mein. You have to, you know, you have to make a nice recipe of it.
Right, right.
I pause here. And
right. So I'm going to come to Arun before then I go to Dr. Chintala. Arun, just in the space, we are still discussing the problems that we've discussed the positives, we've come to the problems. So the problems in the entire derivative space becomes even tougher for agriculture because of the spot and the futures and warehousing and physical delivery. So what would you map out as some of the problem areas in the financialization story?
Thanks, Monica. You know, so far we have been talking about the supply side, but we are doing the whole financialization for people and the people associated with agri. I'll give you a small example. About 3 years ago, I had gone to meet my parents in a small village in Maharashtra. I was listening to a conversation between our maid and my mother. This maid had got some bank account. She had a passbook. She had a debit card, but she didn't know how to use it. And I said, what is the problem? She says, money has come into my account, but I don't know how to use it, and my son is not here. So I took her to the nearest ATM. And then after going there, I realized that the first thing which you put the debit card in, the ATM tells you to choose your language, but that is in English, and which she didn't understand. So building capability right from this angle, where you are looking at building capability of people who will absorb credit, is something which is a requirement. The second part of it is the whole financialization piece needs to look at value addition. What is that we can do in terms of value addition to the existing agriculture products or allied products, agri-allied products, which I mentioned dairy about. So you go one step up in the whole value chain, possibly you have delivered much better than what a primary goods would have fetched. Anil is working on FPOs. Now for me, the desire would be the FPO to have a warehouse so that they can hold their goods. And then from my perspective, if they can trade in ENWRs, electronic warehouse receipts, which fortunately for us, just yesterday, Indian Banks Association has sent a mail to all the bankers that they should promote electronic warehouse receipts because there are a lot of frauds going on. And along with that, the subject of the whole wastage part. So if Anil's FPO owns a warehouse, which is owned, the FPO is owned by farmers and they own a warehouse, the upkeep of the warehouse will be much better than a collateral manager's warehouse. And the whole wastage, which probably in our case is nothing less than 15 to 20% overall across the country, can be, arrested. If you arrest that 20% wastage, that will add to 20% income to the farmers. So from utilization perspective, the financialization should also take care of the capability part of it, whether it is value add, whether it is preserving values, or taking the instruments which will increase the value.
Right, right. No, that's very, very interesting. That one, you're saying that customize it to Bharat financialization.
Exactly.
And the other is really look at the story from the demand side.
Yes.
And then allow the demand side to create the infrastructure that it might need to get a better realization. But it also helps in the financialization story. Very,
exactly.
Very interesting. I am actually going to come to Dr. Chintala. We missed you in the first part of the conversation where we began by discussing some of the positives that we have seen, Dr. Chintala. 5 years ago, the story was that Indian agriculture is going to sink, demonetization, and then COVID was going to finish the story. But that's not what has happened. We are seeing a buoyant sector. We are seeing a lot of good stories, and the conversation in the last half an hour has mapped some of what has happened in the space. To you specifically, what I thought is you could talk about the positives and then some of the problems which we've just finished discussing. And as the institutional big daddy in the space, what are the changes as an institution that you can map And you know, this is a little sensitive, but have you sensed a change in the political will that it's handing over institutions to domain experts rather than sinecures for XYZ? So, because unless there is political will and institutional support, a lot of these struggles simply doesn't bear fruit. And we've seen those stories happen over the years that it is so difficult to do anything. So how would you look at some of the success stories and what are the problems going ahead?
Thank you, Monica. First of all, I'm a little late because we had our Independence Day celebration, so I could join. But otherwise, I was just listening to what Anil and Raste was telling that regarding the past two stories, I think India is full of now past two stories. I think now there's absolutely no moment of despair. And I could, as maybe a chief of NABARD and who is overseeing the entire rural credit space in the country, I had a lot of positive stories to tell. First point with regard to giving the domain experts, you told. I am the beneficiary of the domain expertise. I was part of NABARD for the past 35 years, and being an agricultural postgraduate and a doctorate, and subsequently having worked in 12 or more geographies in the country and in almost every aspect of the rural development, I could see that a domain expert can definitely lend an immediate kind of a gain to the institutions, and definitely that we could see. Now, take the case of positives of the Indian agriculture. Now, since independence also, if you see that from 50 million tons now, actually we have gone so ahead. I think nobody could have ever thought. Now, if I could read the maybe the USDA writing, which that time said that India should not be helped, that was in 1964, because these people will come out with a begging bowl time and again. And that time, actually, India has taken a great leap going for the green revolution. And today, the story everybody knows. But more than that, I think from 2000 onwards, I think now at the turn of the century or the millennium, I think now suddenly things have taken a totally different kind of a paradigm. Earlier, horticulture was not a very great activity, and it used to be done in some place or other. And okay, now people are not having a much of a great thing about, not to rave about this thing. But from 2000 onwards, ever since that National Horticulture Mission and the National Horticulture Board has been set up, today that you find a sea change in the entire horticulture production. Now that horticulture production crosses the agriculture production. Now it is 326 million tons is the horticultural produce, and 308 million tons is the agricultural produce. Now at the same time, if you really look into it, the consumption pattern. Earlier, actually, whenever somebody was trying to buy the fruits, the people on the street used to ask whether somebody is ill at home. But today it is not the case. Even the rickshaw puller is also getting, because the affordability has gone up substantially. The productivity has gone up, production has gone up. And the good part of the story is the credit institutions. Now, because being in that institution for almost last 3.5 decades, I can say one thing, that India's credit story is unparalleled in the world. I have seen many countries, and thing is, nowhere actually a budget announcement will happen for the agricultural credit the way it happens in India. Now imagine that, you know, from 2000 onwards, we are doing quite a lot, but 2007 onwards, ever since the government of India has made this budget announcement and also interest subvention, today the credit is accessible to everyone. And last year, despite the pandemic, again, I'll put in the inverted commas, it is despite the pandemic, Indian banking and the para banking had delivered more than 15.5 lakh crores against the target of 15 lakh crores. That was against all odds. And also that our belief during the pandemic was that nothing can stop agriculture, and things agriculture is a continuum, and now we have produced the record kind of things. And this year also, I am pretty confident that our target of 16.5 lakh crores, actually the entire banking industry is going to achieve, and the food grain targets are not a big issue. Now I think we are achieving it year and again. So the next part of the story is the paradigm shift that had been witnessed in the entire country with regard to the collectivization. I think my previous speakers also might have spoken, but thing is, being the progenitor and the organization which had conceptualized, piloted, rolled it out at a great level that now today we are having around 5,000 farmer producers organizations of NABARD, where the collectivization had happened to such a great level. And now I could go around when I was moving around the states, I just go around and talk to them, and some of them are already doing a business of 15 crores, 20 crores, and some of them 50 lakhs, 100 lakhs. And the kind of an energy really around the people are talking about. Just a day before I was in Karnal, and so now you have to see to believe it really how people are looking into the market-centric production. NABARD, for the past 1.5 years, we are telling everybody from top, right from PM's office to the lower level also, or maybe wherever actually we got an opportunity, we say that the Indian agriculture should move away from the farmer-centric production process to the customer-centric and market-centric production process. And now that already had happened, why I'm telling you is the other day, now that you might be knowing the story of Indian basmati, in the last 1 year, 2 years, because of the pesticide residue, actually our basmati is not able to get into the international market in a big way. Now there is a lot of concern among the farmers. Now actually that India is the GA producing kind of a basmati producing country, and there is nobody better than Indians or maybe Indian agriculture to produce basmati to the world. Nowhere else it is produced except a small part in China, Pakistan. But the pesticide residue problem is really creating problems. So now the FPO, the exporter, EPEDA, NABARD, all of them came together, and I was addressing them, discussing with them for almost 3 hours, and actually a kind of a protocol had been prescribed, and already the first crop has been done, really how to reduce the entire pesticides and all those things. And the way the farmers started responding to the market centric approach is something which is maybe a thing to really clap, or maybe the this thing now encourage. And the same thing is happening with regard to the diversification in Haryana, actually Haryana for that matter, many places wherever there is a certain irrigation. There is a kind of a mindset not to diversify from the paddy, but thing is now the people are slowly diversifying to the vegetables, fruits and others. And so that doubling of farmer income is going to be a reality. Now, having seen all these things, actually, I can say that we have conducted a study. Many of you might have read that NAFI study, NABARD Financial Inclusion Survey study, which we have conducted across the country in all the states, and we found there is a wide-ranging disparity in the income levels of the farm household. I'm not saying the per capita farm or something. In the farm household, actually, if it starts at 2.8 lakhs in Punjab, Haryana, and it comes to only 40,000 rupees in the Bundelkhand, and the farmers' households and members are same, and their aspirations are same, their needs are same, but at the same time, the production levels, productivity levels, and the income levels are different. So now we have to create an ecosystem to go for kind of an integrated farming system. So now the entire credit approach, actually, when Vasudev was telling, that is supply side, actually now the supply side is there or not. Actually, in some cases, even the supply side also has to be rejigged. Now, the way the production process is happening, actually, we have to do something. And the second part is with regard to the demand side are creating the infra. Now, actually, the FPOs are a reality, and that is going to be the new paradigm for the Indian agriculture, because unless there is a collectivization, nothing is going to happen. As the land is getting fragmented to such a low level, people cannot afford to have a tractor or any kind of a thing. So now, when this kind of a collectivization is happening, there are two or three issues. One is the value chain financing. Second thing is value chain financing is basically a working capital kind of a thing. But thing is the value chain financing requires a kind of a investment credit with regard to the creating godowns or cold storages. So many of the FPOs probably may not be in a position. So recently, just maybe 5 days back, NABARD had signed an agreement with the Central Warehousing Corporation, which is having close to 2,500 locations, their godowns are there, or in some cases, cold storages are there. And the agreement, specifics of the agreement is that whichever FPO wants to avail that storage facility, CWC is going to give 30% discount to the FPO. Now, that is a game changer that is going to happen. And again, they are going to have that ENWR, that is negotiable warehouse receipts, that also then that will help NCDECs also to integrate themselves with this kind of a thing. And the third one is with regard to the logistics. Actually, why the farmer should every time go to the lorry owner to just plead for this? So now, these kind of organizations already having that kind of a logistics support. So now, quite a lot of things are happening. So very positively, I can say that now everything, I think it's a process. Actually, now I cannot say that today is the end. Actually, every day we will invent. And I have seen a great amount of a convergence right now among the credit institutions, among the institutions like that warehousing corporations, among the market makers like NCDECs and MCX, and also with the last mile reachers like that Anil and others, the companies like, you know, maybe which are basically into the normal finance, but they are taking a very big leap into the entire agri financing also value chain. And we have our own subsidiary, NAP Kisan, which is already at 1200 crores we are lent to the FPOs, and a substantial kind of a things are happening. And also that putting the entire FPOs onto a kind of a technology platform. Actually, that agri stack everybody was talking about, so far nobody was able to do it at a national level. But there are many attempts are being done at the individual levels, which are that will integrate from that maybe the input supplier to the seed supplier to the creditor to ultimately coming to the maybe the aggregators at the village level, at the taluk level, at the district, and finally at the processor level, insurers, logistics suppliers, and actually a plethora of things can happen with that kind of an agri stack kind of a platform that I think many people are attempting. But the thing is, the cost may be humongous in case if you have to put all the 140 million people on the web. But someday it is going to be realized. Otherwise, maybe we have to integrate all those things from whosoever has made it and whatever. And also the other thing is with regard to the software with the FPOs. Now that most of the FPOs are in a very professional kind of a environment. Actually, they got a CEO and they have to have that returns to the government and others. So now that software which triggers all such kinds of returns and everything also is a new reality. Many people are developed, but there should be a standardization. So I will stop here with regard to the past two things, and we will again take part
right.
in the
right. Dr. Chintala, just I'm going to encapsulate what you said, that what you see as positive is that agriculture has been a really deep part of even things like the Indian budget, which you've not seen anywhere else. And COVID did not destabilize agriculture and credit. It could have, but it didn't. Collectivization has been a great story. And the biggest thing that I think through the conversation that I'm hearing, that markets are not being seen negatively anymore. There is a whole positive feeling about markets, about modern finance, which used to be in the whole socialist mindset, it used to be a threat, it used to be the evil capitalist. That feeling probably is going, and the animal spirits are there within the agricultural sector with a lot of energy coming in. There is a problem-solving attitude. One thing that I want to ask you again specifically is that for a sector like agriculture, which is deep, problems are deep and wide, it takes a huge amount of coordination. It's like a symphony. One of the panelists mentioned it. And I think the problem in India has always been turf of institutions to the detriment of the larger thing that everyone's trying to do. Have you noticed any shift in that coordination?
Yeah, Monica, it's a very good point. Now, coordination. Now, earlier, generally, everybody wants to safeguard their trust. That was a very common thing, whether it is the banks or anything. But today, quite a lot of a convergence is happening, because now we could see the entire agricultural credit rollout from the national perspective. And we ourselves give substantial refinance to the cooperatives and RRBs for everything. And also the government of India, in its endeavor to put the farmers' credit at the lowest cost, to keep him in the farming, actually the government of India doles out quite a lot of a subvention, actually almost close to around 3,000 to 4,000 crores every year. I think it's almost more than that, around 15,000 to 20,000 crores. And this is a very good thing. So at one level, there is a kind of a convergence that happened with regard to the government agriculture ministry devising methods to just give the subvention to the banks. And in turn, the banks will give the money to the farmers. And also the caveat they have put is that unless the farmer repays it, he will not get that 3% of that incentive. PRI incentive. So now, prompt repayment incentive. So now, in case if these things are there, actually a level of coordination happened with regard to the credit part. And second thing is, generally there is a common kind of thing. Many times the people, the armchair critics say that now actually so much of credit is being given, but the agriculture production remains same. Actually, it is not. Actually, the story is totally different. As an industry specialist, I could say that in 2000, if I look into it, not more than 40% of the Indian farmers were getting institutional credit. Today, more than 86% of the farmers are getting the institutional credit at the levels of 4% or 0%, depending on the state which they operate. So now that itself is the greatest story, which right. I can say, the convergence part. And the second thing is now the turf thing. Actually, now that maybe everybody, EPEDA wants to do their own, EMPEDA wants to do on their own, dairy development wants to do on their own, cooperatives have got their own kind of a things. So now many times actually attempts are being made to bring the convergence. And so that everybody has to talk to each other. Now, maybe in the last 1 year, I could forge link with EPEDA, I could forge link with CWC. Every day we will talk to the Agriculture Ministry and the Rural Development Ministry as to what is happening. And you can look into the way NABARD interacts with all the NBFCs and MFIs. I think it was not happening maybe sometime back. Actually, maybe 3-4 years back, actually NABARD was not in this space at all. Today, we are one of the biggest financiers and also the sector kind of a makers also we are doing it. And also the small finance bank. So now these are the things happening. The next one is that with regard to the convergence, as you are telling, the tough players. Take the case of FPOs. FPOs have got a plethora of returns. So now actually all those things have been streamlined. And the various ministries were trying to iron out. And the next part of the story is many of the state governments are so happy to talk to NABARD and trying to devise a mechanism to give the mezzanine capital to the FPOs so that their borrowing power will go up. And some of them started giving some kind of a grants to those FPOs to create, put the machinery so that the valuation can happen. And the other convergence, because I had seen at least in 10, 15 FPOs wherever I had gone recently, that the convergence of the industry is there with the FPOs, that Reliance Fresh, then the Big Bazaar, maybe Grofers, and you just name Amazon, everyone is in touch with these FPOs. And they have that specifications, and this FPO is producing to their specifications. Okay. And the next part is with regard to the integration with regard to the ministries, various ministries. Like in every state government, fertilizer, somebody has to give a permission. Pesticide, somebody has to give them a seed, somebody has to give a permission. But after our maybe talking to many of the state governments, actually now most of the FPOs have got the distribution rights of pesticide, fertilizer, seed, and this kind of thing. So actually they are retaining that dealer's margin of the 20-30%, which is being passed on. So quite a lot of things are happening, but still actually it is, I'm telling, it's a humongous task, right. And we have to do much more than what we have done.
Right, right. So we are going to be in the last 5-7 minutes. I can see the clock ticking. I'll just go to each person. Anil, first you. Just very quick comments on the conversation till now, and also crystal gazing for the next 5 years. To see where does the sector go to? What do you see ahead?
Now, as Dr. Chintala combined the integrated approach to the power of collectivization. You know, we are seeing that vision of what he is articulating on the ground day in and day out. Samunathi works with a lot of farmer producer organizations. Mm-hmm. 3-4 things that I certainly would crystal gaze. You know, one is an integrated approach where the hierarchy of needs that I was mentioning, the bazaar looks from the dimension of a integrated approach to customized financial solutions, market linkages, and advisory services with risk mitigation. And integrators coming in who hold all of this together and not expect the farmers and farmer producer organizations to take that role is one thing that I would certainly see. Second, at a policy level, I certainly would hope that the focus will be on the outcome and on the intended beneficiary of all these efforts than get locked into who is producing all of this. You know, it should be vehicle agnostic, right? If there is a bank doing it, if there is a small finance bank doing it, if it is a non-bank finance company doing it, if it is a fintech company doing it, one should be agnostic. We should be agnostic of the vehicle. Are the services which are intended to reach the beneficiary reaching? That's a significant shift that we are already seeing, and that's how I would be looking at. And most of the policies, again, aligned to the first and second dimensions of focusing on the outcomes. And this is a moment of, I would say, the vegetative phase to the harvesting phase in agriculture.
Right. So you're seeing an integrated approach for policy. You're hoping that it focuses on outcome and is vehicle agnostic. Arun, quick comments. We are running out of time.
So for me, there are two things which has happened. If you say microfinance, it had enabled gender. But the current financialization process, as you mentioned, it is what it is leading to is bringing democratization of markets and FPOs. What it is leading to is enabling people to take their own decisions at grassroots, enabling them to access market, and enabling them to influence market. So more power to FPOs, more power to people who are enabling it. At the end of the day, if they are enabled, possibly our GDP will keep on growing at the rate we are envisaging.
Right. So democratization of markets, which is very powerful, and also the transfer of power, this whole Maibaap attitude, which has really sucked out our lifeblood. We are seeing a shift in that is what I'm hearing. Rahul, comments from you?
One is, I think the feudal forces have to be done away with. And in the spirit of, empowering collectives, I think if you look at community-centric systems and collectives, I think they have to play a much bigger part in both the demand side as well as the supply side, where they have much more control and agency on outcomes that they need to strive for. Okay. I think that's important. And if I was to, and therefore today, I mean, even if we talk about financialization or financial services for this segment, we all suffer from the fact that we try to offer what we have. It's not a product that necessarily people want. And how do we sort of change that game and give more agency to people who deserve it? And lastly, if I was to crystal gaze to your last point, Monica, I would hope that in at least the next 7 to 10 years, a farmer in any part of the country gets access to financial services in as frictionless a manner and at the same rate that any one of us on this panel will get it today.
Wonderful. So we want feudal forces down. Collectivization is the road to the future, and also really modern finance reaching everywhere in the country, last to the last mile. Dr. Chintala, last brief comments before we wrap.
Thank you. It's a very positive kind of a thing, but I could say only a few things. One is market orientation of agriculture. This is the first. So that will automatically take away the feudal forces dictating the terms. The next one is the democratization of the institutions. Already that had happened. And at the same time, that access to the credit should be ensured to everyone with the financial literacy, which we are all attempting it. And the third one is that market-centric production process, and where entire financial products also should be devoted to that kind of a market-centric things. Because we have seen, if somebody wants to go for that export market, he cannot go with a pittance of a money to be put in the field. Actually, he has to have invest quite a lot. So now this is the third thing. And the fourth thing is that maybe looking into that international markets. Now today, actually, India is no more the ship to mouth. Actually, we are now from farm to ship. Actually, that we are able to export quite a lot. If it is the farm to ship, is already the change that had happened. Now we have to look into this one, and today we have exported close to around $40 billion last year, agriculture produce, but that is just hardly 0.2% of the global market. And if we have to increase it to maybe some 10% or maybe anything, actually we have to increase our capabilities to do this one. So now the moment we are aiming at maybe at least $100 to $200 billion as the agricultural exports, which will put substantial money in the hands of the farmers at the back end. We need to have integration of approaches. We need to have convergence of policies, convergence of the players. And finally, I will say that at any point of a time, it is nothing but talk with everyone, the stakeholder, right from farmer to NBFC, to small finance bank, to the commercial bank, to the aggregator, to the insurer, to the processor. and to the government, to institutions like NABARD, RBI, and to the government of India, so that everything will be done in a coordinated approach. And I am very, very optimistic. Why? As I was looking into it. In 2003-04, in case if we are delivering only 56,000 crores of a credit, today we have added just another 15 lakh crores to that. From 56,000, we are adding 15.58 lakh crores is the one. So now imagine in 10 years or 12 years, really what kind of a transformation had happened in the mindset of the people. So the democratization had happened. And if I look into the thing, even in the places like Bihar, actually FPOs are doing very well. The most feudalistic society, if you really rate it. Now that indicates actually that process has already set in and things are going to happen. And institutions and the policy makers and the opinion makers, actually now these are the people, actually they all have to come onto a common platform to see that things work.
I think that opinion piece is a little difficult because some of the popular discourse is fairly still in the 1980s. But anyhow, it's been a great panel and it's been a great learning for me personally, because I've understood that what we're looking at is a greater integration. We're looking at actually on the ground democratization of power or financialization of the sector. And we're looking at actually a power shift where the farmer is being given the respect that he and she can actually take their own decisions. And this top down bureaucracy led freebies and doles are actually on the back seat. But there has been more a shift towards, I love this phrase, Samaj, Sarkar, Bazaar. And as a person who understands the other financial sector very well, my own personal prediction would be that we are looking at the unicorns today of Zomato and all these coming to the market to raise capital. My prediction would be in 5 to 7 years, we should be seeing some of the agri-tech firms, some of the businesses associated in agriculture coming to market to harvest the capital. I want to thank each of the panelists. Thank you so much for your valuable time. And thank you to the audience. Back to you, Roshni.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure having you all and a happy Independence Day again. Bye-bye.